can you do this? This part?
So,
yeah. Okay. We're going to read a piece from a play called The London Merchant, which was actually written by a merchant in 1731 in response to what was happening in the world. Merchants were coming into being in England. It was written in England at the time. And what was happening, because we were shifting from an agricultural system to an industrial system, a lot of women were being, young girls were being thrown out into the streets by their families because there wasn't enough to feed everyone, and they had to fend for themselves. So the apprentices who were working for the merchants were stealing from the merchants and giving to these young girls so they wouldn't have to prostitute themselves. Well, this play was written by a merchant who was angry about this, and it's set in total principles. It's complete principles, and it's very black and white. But the queen loved it so much as a educational tool for the masses that she the queen's court showed it for 100 years to apprentices every Christmas. So it was an educational tool in England about how to behave or the evil will get you. And the evil character is a woman, the first feminist. And so we're gonna do a scene out of it.
For some balance
from the program.
Right. Yes. Right. So the scene is they've caught her. So what she's actually done, this character is a beautiful, sophisticated woman who's seduced a young boy into stealing, not only stealing, but murdering his uncle, who's very wealthy, and bringing his money to her. And of course, she's disowned him, so she's got the money. But her maid told on her, and her maid's boyfriend, his name is Blunt. And there's Mr. Thorogood and Mr. Truman. These people are really archetypal characters. So this is just a small scene when she's finally caught. She's already tried to deflect the scene before, but now she knows she's red-handedly caught. And they both get hanged, both the young boy and she in the end get hanged. And there's a whole dialogue with them getting ready to hang and God and all this stuff. And it's really interesting. It was used to propagandize the ability to manipulate the masses at the time.
We should do this play.
Yeah, it's a classic. I have learned it in theater history. My teacher gave me this assignment, so I've used it a lot. So.
Here thy power of doing mischief ends, deceitful, cruel, bloody woman.
Fool! Hypocrite! Villain! Man! Thou canst not call me that!
To call thee woman were to wrong thy sex, thou devil.
That imaginary being is an emblem of thy cursed sex collected. A mirror wherein each particular man may see his own likeness, and that of all mankind.
Think not by aggravating the faults of others to extenuate thy own, which the abuse of such uncommon perfections of mind and body is not the least.
If such I had, may well I curse your barbarous sex, who robbed me of a mare I knew their worth. They left me too late to count their value by their loss. Another and another spoiler came, and all my gain was poverty and reproach. My soul disdained, and yet disdains dependence and contempt. Riches, no matter by what means obtained, I saw, secured the worst of men from both. I found it, therefore, necessary to be rich. And to that end, I summoned all my arts. You call them wicked, be it so. They were such as my conversation with your sex had furnished me withal.
Sure, none but the worst of men conversed with thee.
Men of all degrees and all professions I have known, yet found no difference, but in their several capacities, all were alike, wicked to the utmost of their power. In pride, contention, avarice, cruelty, and revenge, the reverend priesthood were my unerring guides. From suburb magistrates, who lived by the ruined reputations as the unhospitable natives of Cornwall do by shipwrecks, I learned that to charge my innocent neighbors with my crimes was to merit their protection. For to screen the guilty is the less scandalous when many are suspected, and detraction, like darkness and death, blackens all objects and levels all distinction. Such are your venal magistrates, who favor none but such as by their oaths they are sworn to punish. With them, not to be guilty is the worst of crimes, and large fees privately paid are every needful virtue.
Your practice has sufficiently discovered your contempt of laws, both human and divine. No wonder that you should hate the officers of both.
I know you, and I hate you all. I expect no mercy mercy, and I asked for none. I followed my inclinations, and that the best of you do every day. All actions seem alike, natural and indifferent to man and beast, who devour, or are devoured, as they meet with others weaker or stronger than themselves.
What a pity it is. A mind so comprehensive, daring, and inquisitive should be a stranger to religion's sweet and powerful charms.
I am not fool enough to be an atheist, though I have known enough of men's hypocrisy to make 1,000 simple women so. Whatever religion is in itself, as practiced by mankind, it has caused the evils you say it was designed to cure. Wars, plague, and famine has not destroyed so many of the human race as this pretended piety. Pity, whichever it is, has done, and with such barbarous cruelty, as if the only way to honor heaven were to turn the present world into hell.
Truth is truth, though from an enemy in spoken malice. You bloody, blind, and superstitious bigots, how will you answer this?
What are your laws? How would you make your boast? But the fool's wisdom and the coward's valor, the instrument and screen of all your villainies by which you punish in others what you act yourselves, or would have acted had you been in their circumstances? The judge who condemns the poor man for being a thief had been a thief himself had he been poor. Thus you go on deceiving and being deceived, harassing, plaguing, and destroying one another. But women are your universal prey. Women, by whom you are the source of joy, with cruel arts you labor to destroy. 1,000 ways our ruin you pursue, yet blaming us those arts first taught by you. Oh, may from hence each violated maid, by flattering, faithless, barbarous man betrayed, when robbed of innocence and virgin fame, from your destruction raise a nobler name, to right their sex's wrongs, devote their mind, and future Millwoods prove to plague mankind. That was written in 1731, and the important part of it is, in 1775, a man named George Campbell wrote a book called The Philosophy of Rhetoric, which has been used in communication, the arts of persuasion, communication studies since then. And he shifted the speakers, the importance of the speaker from being speaker-centered, where it was up to the speaker to have ethos, logos, and pathos, logic, ethics, and passion, and be able to be believable, to audience-centered communication, which he realized by, I wrote a paper that suggests that it was through watching this play, that 100 years at Drury Lane, Drury Theater, that he postulated these principles, because they're actually in this play. And they are, he's the one who said that they're, that every person, no matter what educational level they were from, they didn't have to be well-bred or well-educated, that every human being had 4 psychological faculties: the ability to be instructed, have their imaginations aroused, their passions moved, and their wills changed. So rhetoric shifted from speaker-centered to audience-centered, and that's how we all got on this advertising kick. It's like, so, good to know you. Thanks. Who's next? Marcus.
Yeah.
Noreen and then Carol. Marcus.
So, a part of me that a lot of you don't see, actually I bring it out now and then, but I'm also a singer, and I prepared in the same vein of classical music. I've been involved in a musical theater company for 2 years, a studio repertory company, which is based in the East Bay. And the director has been on a Mozart kick for about the past 3 years. So I'm about to do, I think, my fourth performance of Don Giovanni. And the first time I played the part of Leporello, hapless servant, which I found is actually very comfortable for me to play the low status character. So I've been playing low status for most of my life, and high status. Anyway, this time I'm playing the part of Don Giovanni, which is very different than the nobleman, the womanizer.
Your true nature.
So anyway, I wanted to sing. Actually, I was going to sing the part of a section of Leporello and a section of Giovanni. Leporello's pretty well established. Giovanni's still in rehearsal, but here goes. This is the opening of the play. And what's happening is Giovanni is trying to, has climbed into Donna Anna's window and is trying to seduce Donna Anna and has left poor Leporello out in the cold to play the sentry. On the go from morn till night, running errands never free, hardly time to snatch a bite. This is not the life for me. I would like to play the master, would no more a servant be, would no more a servant be. No, 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 I would a master be. What a difference between us. Warm he lies in arms of beauty, while I freeze on sentry duty, on sentry duty, on sentry duty. I would like to play the master, would no more a servant be, would no more a servant be. No, 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 I would a master be. What was that? We're in for trouble. What was that? We're in for trouble. This is not the life for me. No, this is not the life for me. This is not the life for me. No, 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 no. This is not the life for me.
Yay!
And of course, something appropriate to the occasion, which is Don Giovanni singing the champagne aria.
Ah, cool.
Now that you've gotten your wish to be the master.
Yeah. All things are ready, dainties and plenty, wine on the table, candles aglow. Off Leporello down to the village, bring me more girls back, willing or no. Bring me more girls back, willing or no, willing or no. Willing or no, while to the violin dances go flying, mad with excitement, pulses are throbbing, swirling and twirling, light on the toe, mad with excitement, light on the toe, pulses are throbbing, light on the toe, swirling and twirling, light on the toe. Noticed by no one, I shall be busy playing that game where maids cry, oh, where maids cry, oh, where maids cry, oh. In the morning, bring me my list, and down a full dozen more shall go. Yes, in the morning, at least a dozen more shall go. Quick, Leporello, down to the village, bring me more girls back, willing or no. Then, in the morning, bring me my list, and down a full dozen more shall go. While to the violin, let them go flying, mad with excitement, pulses a-throbbing, swirling a-twirling, light on the toe. Then, in the morning, bring me my list, and down a full dozen more shall go. More than a dozen down shall go, more than a dozen down shall go. Down they go, more, 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 more shall go. College in June.
Oh, great! I hope I get the videotape. Yeah. Who's next? Who's on the list?
Noreen, who's been
Noreen.
A friend for many, many years.
Yes.
And,
do you want to stay there? Yeah, I'll find you. Can you put your knee down, darling? Thanks.
So I invited Marcus to a 33 to 33 time, in which I...
You're only infinite once.
Right, you're only infinite once.